Not enough, there's no time at all. But this isn't farewell. I'll see you again. Tears may fall, I know you're with God. I know it is well. I'll dry my eyes, I'll remember your smile. I know it is well. There's a home in the sky, far above the big blue horizon, where you continue to fly, a place where your spirit never dies. This isn't farewell, I'll see you again. 'Cause good men never die. No. How do I start to tell the world your story? How do I write this beautiful journey? Yeah. Words are not enough. There's no time at all. But this isn't farewell. I'll see you again. Tears may fall, I know you're with God. I know it is well. I'll dry my eyes, I'll remember your smile. I know it is well. There's a home in the sky, far above the big blue horizon, where you continue to fly, a place where your spirit never dies. This isn't farewell, I'll see you again, 'cause good men never die. No. How do I start to tell the world your story? How do I write this beautiful journey? Yeah. Words are not enough, there's no time at all. But this isn't farewell, I'll see you again. Tears may fall, I know you're with God, I know it is well. I'll dry my eyes, I'll remember your smile, I know it is well. You gave your all and you answered the call, I know it is well. This isn't farewell, I'll see you again. Tears may fall, I know you're with God, I know.
You might be shocked why I said so. Because I remember then, our school fees was 30 naira in government college. And with that, it comes with all the stuff, your provision, your school uniform, everything that you can think of. And I was in school. I was so broke, you know. And now, you know, then it was telegram. I sent a telegram to my brother in Zaria. I was in flying school then. As usual, I need some money. I thought it was a joke. But really, I needed some money though. And I sent it to him. And the next thing, a slip came then. There's usually this blue suit that came and they covered. And I went, I cashed the money. How much was it? 10 naira. So you can imagine me having 10 naira when my school fees was 30 naira. I now became one of the richest students in school then, before it was just before closing. And I value that so much. And why did that? For me to have even found out later that he sent that money to me from his sick bed because he had an accident. You know, I can never ever forget that.
Captain flew actively for 9 years and was only 30 when he stopped. It was from childhood an enchanting passion. What did it really mean to the Captain Hosa? And which alternative vision caused the rupture in his old romance? Why did he give up the joystick in 1988?
I got married in 1986. And before that, some of my friends are started relocating.
Captain Hosa did not like routines.
I'm not a dozy person, and I don't like routine. Yes, I left flying school very young. You know, I was trained in Zaria by aero contractors. And at the age of 21, early 1979, I was already a professional pilot. For me, at a point, flying became a routine. You know, gears down, gears up, gears down, gears up, you know, and I don't like routines. And that is what actually made me at that early age, when I was 30, you know, that became a routine for me.
How seriously did Hosa take his job?
I took my job very seriously. And whatever I do in life, I always try to be the best.
Captain Hosa remarkably started flying planes before he could drive a car.
I actually learned how to fly a plane first. Yes. I learned how to fly a plane first before driving a car. Very young. You know, I was trained in Zaria by aerocontractors. And at the age of 21, early 1979, I was already a professional pilot. I would have been a pilot, a professional pilot, at the age of 20. I lost 1 year in flying school because I had an accident.
The lure of business eventually overpowers the magic of flying.
I resigned from Mukada in 1988. And my resignation was accepted by Chief Ignatian. And he actually prayed for me and wish me the best. That's how I plunged into business, and I concentrated and I focused on my procurement in the refinery.
Captain Hosa was raised on a huge convention of regard for integrity. If labor produces profit, it must do so in dignity and truth. Captain Hosa, starting from very humble levels as a procurement agency, would become one of the biggest players in the Nigerian oil industry. Nowhere has his intervention been more decisive than his success against all odds in supplying crude by marine vessels to our refineries and ultimately his restoration of Nigeria's pipeline infrastructure. This has frequently put him in the public eye and sometimes cost unkind and poorly thought out insinuations. More clarity has now been produced, and it is helped by the presentation of Engineer Rabiu Suleiman, Group Executive Director, Engineering at the NNPC. But what really are the issues?
So in everything I've done in my life, I've always looked at dignity of labor, supported by integrity. Since 2015, of course, with the advent of a new government, my contract in NNPC was challenged. We're doing crude movement by vessel for NNPC. That contract actually was awarded in 2009. And we were in charge of providing security for the storage and the delivery of crude using marine vessels to the refineries, because the pipelines were moribund and completely dilapidated, and they were no longer available, you know, to deliver crude to Warri Refinery, and even Port Harcourt Refinery also shut down. But whenever they threw crude into those lines, they were losing about 40% of the crude. You can imagine pumping 1 million barrels and losing 400,000 barrels. So it was no longer a viable option. So this concept of using crude by vessel was initiated, and an international bid also actually was thrown out there by NNPC. And we're recommended by the Navy, you know, to NNPC, as at then, that look, they should approach us to provide platforms for them, because that was the model, as in then, that we were operating with the Navy, because we had a close relationship with the Navy, an MOU with the Navy, to provide them platforms for dedicated services.
The issue has been one of great challenge. Engineer Rabiu Suleiman has a ringside understanding of the matter.
At a time when NNPC was suffering from lack of crude oil supplies to put our core refinery, Warri refinery, and Kaduna refinery, as a result of militancy, willful vandalization of pipelines in the Niger Delta. A very challenging situation. And at that time, NNPC was receiving crude through alternative means rather than the conventional pipeline supplies from Escravos to Warri, which provides for Warri and Kaduna, and from Boni Terminal to Warri to Port Harcourt Refinery. But at that time, because of the damage that went on and ending, those crude pipelines were not available. So there was an alternative arrangement to supply crude by vessels across from Escravos to Warri and from Boni to Port Harcourt at an unprecedented high cost per barrel. Captain Hosa was directly and indirectly managing that contract for the crude oil supply by ship. In 2015, the need to revisit the supply of crude oil was determined as crude oil price was going down. The government was no longer in position to continue to get crude oil supplied at about 5 naira 60 cents per barrel by sea, by shipping. And the amnesty program did not work. And therefore, going back to the creeks to repair the pipelines was challenging. So I was mandated with the tax to be the chairman of a task force committee that should repair the pipeline at that critical time.
However, the mandate of Ocean Marine would be further expanded after initial misapprehension.
So we're there to provide that platform for the Navy. And it's a purely Navy operation, you know, and we're just logistics provider. And we're called upon Ocean Marine to provide our logistics, you know, for the Navy to be able to carry out their statutory responsibility of escorting those vessels.
But unresolved questions remained.
It also coincided at the time when the new regime 2015 came in, frowning at the crude oil supply, and the contract for the supply by shipment was terminated. And we're asked to see what we can do to bring back that contract in order that the refineries continue to get crude oil supplies. For normal conventional contractors and oil and gas technicians, management and engineers, they do not appreciate the fact that you cannot keep refineries without crude oil going through them for a long time. So if the contract for supply of crude was terminated, an alternative source was not determined, corrosions will set in the refinery and the pipelines. And should that happen, you may wake up one day you don't even have the asset.
Captain Hosa, though involved only with the security and logistics of crude movement, was unhappy with both volume and integrity of the process.
What my father used to tell us as children, he always warned us that the only thing he had, that he didn't have money, but the only thing he had was his good name, and that we must never mess up that name. The month after they started, we noticed that they had only delivered 200,000 barrels to the refinery and they stopped. The VLCC, which had the storage, had about 600,000 barrels. And the MR, which is the 45,000-tonner vessel, which was a shuttle vessel, had 100,000 barrels packed at the water refinery, not discharging the crude. And we're wondering, was already accusing NNPC of not paying their bills. That they had sent an invoice to NNPC and NNPC did not pay their bills. While in actual fact, on the inside, the contract that was executed between NNPC and PPPFM was flawed. And that's why, you know, sometimes I wonder in this country why we look at foreigners when we have so much capacity and competence in this.
There's a home in the sky, far above the big blue horizon.
Good evening, ladies
where
and gentlemen.
You continue to fly, a place
our
where
names are Ike Osakio-Dua and...
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is FX.
We're going to have a wonderful service of songs today, but before we get started with an opening prayer and acknowledgements, just a bit of housekeeping. As you know, we're living through a global pandemic, the COVID-19 virus, so we're going to ask that as much as we're all sat next to each other, familiar with each other, friends of each other, that throughout the course of this service of songs, that you please keep your mask covering your nose and your mouth at all times. We understand how difficult it is to breathe with your mask on, but for the safety of those around you and for the respect of all present, we just ask that you please comply with that. Keep your face mask on throughout the service with covering your nose and your mouth. We'd like to ask that even though you are friends with people that you and haven't seen them in a while, that you refrain from open handshakes, rather shake with an elbow, or you can click legs if you want, just to keep ourselves safe. Also, we are unable to keep the numbers as small as we would have liked to keep you safe. So we're going to ask that you be extra respectful of everyone next to you. If you do feel at all like coughing or sneezing, please make your way out of the venue to do so. I will crave the indulgence of all present. You are family to the family. You are friends to the family. I'm going to ask that, however, you refrain from coming to embrace them, coming to hug them. You can commiserate with them, speak to them, but please refrain from touching them throughout this service. At the end of the service, when we've done the benediction and the closing prayer, I know it is custom for everyone to come around and shake hands and hug and console, but I'm going to plead with you to please refrain from touching the family. We would be very grateful if you would oblige us. Also, if you're in need of the conveniences, the restrooms, you will find them out of this door to my left, your right. You'll make a left. When you come out, you'll find some restrooms over there. The second set of restrooms you'd find at the back of the hall outside. This is a no-smoking venue. We'd like to ask that you please refrain from lighting up even electronic cigarettes. Refrain from that, please. Also, I'm sorry, I know it's a bunch of rules. FX is laughing at me already. We're not by any means trying to be rude or it's just HSC. We have to look out to you, make sure that you are well taken care of. All right, so please, if you do need to light up a cigarette, please make your way out of the venue to do so. Thank you so much for complying with all of that. We'll be starting shortly. It is our custom to be respectful of all the dignitaries present, and we will take a moment to acknowledge you, but we also know that the family is particular about acknowledging God, so we choose first, before acknowledging the many dignitaries that we can see in the house, to acknowledge God Almighty, and I'm sure nobody here has any exception or problem with that. We choose to do that first with praises and worship, and then we'll start with an opening prayer, and after which we will come back to acknowledge our dignitaries. Thank you so much for your patience, for your understanding. Thank you so much. We'll be right back, but ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Lagos City Choral as they come through to lead us with a hymn, after which we will start with an opening prayer. Thank you very much. Please put your hands together for them as they come forward. All right, we'll start with the opening prayer first then. Ladies and gentlemen, my apologies. Please make welcome for the opening prayer, Pastor Osage Ize Iyamo, as he comes to lead us in a prayer. We'd like to ask that the ushers stop the movement in the hall while this is going on.
Amen. Amen. Can we please honor God by standing up, please? Captain loved God, and we must honor that God even tonight. Let the glory of the Lord come down. Let the glory of the Lord come down. Let the glory of the Lord from heaven come down. Let the glory of the Lord come down. One more time. Let the glory of the Lord come down. Let the glory of the Lord come down. Let the glory of the Lord from heaven come down. Let the glory of the Lord come down. Our Father in heaven, our Lord and our God, we gather tonight to celebrate your Son, whom you have called home unto yourself. We celebrate him, Lord, because we are conscious of your word. In Philippians chapter 1, verse 21, Apostle Paul said, "For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." Captain Idaosa Wezo Kumbo lived a Christ-like life. And while many might mourn his departure, heaven has gained a saint. Many of us have read the Acts of the Apostles. Many to come would also hear about the Acts of Captain Osa Okumbo. Captain defined what it means to work hard. He defined friendship. He defined compassion. Captain defined loyalty. Captain defined worship. He loved God. And every time he had the opportunity, he worshiped God. Captain will tell you, if not for God, where would I have been? And so tonight, we are glad and we rejoice because his deeds speak for him. He touched me. Oh, what joy that fills my soul. Something happened, now I know. He touched me and made me whole. He touched many of us. He touched us. He touched us. Oh, what joy that fills our soul. Something happened, now we know. He touched us and made me whole. Father, we commit every aspect of this transition to your hand. We pray, Lord, that you would make it glorious. We ask, O God, that the heavenly host would take charge of our brother, our friend, our father, our benefactor. Let the heavens rejoice about his coming. The impact he made was profound. And Lord, we commit his family, the wife, the children, the siblings, the friends, and the associates unto you, Lord. We ask, Lord, that you will watch over them. We pray, Lord, in particular for the family, that, Lord, you will not allow adversaries to conspire to assemble and scatter what Captain has gathered. We pray, Lord, that you will not allow household enemies, unfriendly friends to sneak in and sow seeds of discord. We pray, Lord, that your grace will be intense in the Okumba home. Lord, you would bless them. You would watch over them. You will not allow lamentation to remain in their home. Your word says, weeping might endure for the night, but joy cometh in the morning. We speak joy to this family. We speak joy to the wife and to the children. And we decree by the grace of God that you will be greater than your father. You will be greater than Captain Osa Okumbo. Lord, we pray for all those who are coming from far and near that, Lord, you will bring them. There will be no violence. There will be no division. Everything will go smoothly. And Lord, we pray that you will teach the family the secret of Captain's success. His secret was God. And Lord, as we close this prayer, we'll take this worship song. Jehovah Shammah, I see you everywhere. Blessed Redeemer, your glory fills the earth. Everlasting Father, the one who watches me, I put my confidence alone in Jehovah Shammah. One more time. Jehovah Shammah, I see you everywhere. Blessed Redeemer, your glory fills this place. Everlasting Father, the one who watches me, I put my confidence alone in Jehovah Shammah. Father, we bless you. Take all the honor and glory. In Jesus' name, we pray.
The choir will now lead us in the hymn, In Christ Alone.
Thank you. please appreciate the choir.
Can we please give them a better round of applause? I think that was amazing. Thank you.
All right, with the proper procedure complied with, acknowledging God first, now we can acknowledge men. FX.
Your Excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, of course, wherever we are seated, we're very much welcomed. We are members of families and close friends who have come to celebrate the life of Capitano the Greatest. But it's only proper that we just quickly run through some names and appreciate some of our guests who have come all the way to celebrate the life of this man with the family. First on my list, permit me to recognize and welcome His Excellency, the Deputy Governor of Edo State, here seated with his wife. Please put your hands together for Right Honorable Philip Shoaibu and his beautiful wife. Thank you for coming. May I also recognize His Excellency, a man that doesn't require a lot of introductions, a very small man by stature, but big man with a big heart. Please put your hands together for a former Labour leader, a two-time Governor of Edo State, a former national chairman of the APC. Please put your hands together for Adams Aliyu Eric Oshomole. In that same vein, may I also recognize a former deputy governor, and of course, a former deputy governor of Edo State, and a former chief of staff of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. Ladies and gentlemen, Chief Mike Ogyadome. Give him a round of applause. I also have a former member of the Federal House of Representatives and a former Deputy Governor of Edo State. Please, a round of applause for the Okakwo of the Universe, Right Honorable Dr. Pius Egberame Odubu. Another former Deputy Governor of Edo State is also here. Please put your hands together for Chief Lucky Imaswen. You're welcome, sir. The Senator representing the good people of Edo South in Abuja here. Please put your hands together for Pharmacist Matthew Urogide. You're welcome, sir. May I also recognize His Royal Highness, the Crown Prince of the Benin Kingdom. With all due respect, can we please put our hands together for His Royal Highness, Prince Eze Ewaye. Give him a big round of applause. Domo, sir. I also recognize in a very, very special way the representatives of the Olu of Wori. I can see a lot and a lot and a lot of his very wonderful looking chiefs here. Please, let's put our hands together for His Royal Majesty, the Olu of Wori, Atuwase the Third. Please give them a round of applause with his chiefs here. I also like to recognize another son of a soil, the former Inspector General of Police seated here. Please, let's put our hands together for IGP retired Solomon Arase. You're welcome, sir. I would like to also recognize some men of God that are seated here already. Please put your hands together for our own Bishop Ogboma, who is already seated. You're welcome, Bishop. I also would recognize Bishop Ukundaye, who is already seated. You're welcome, Bishop. In that same vein, we welcome specially back to Edo State in the grand style. Please put your hands together for Pastor Itua Igodalo. You're welcome, Pastor. Ladies and gentlemen, in a special way, we also recognize and appreciate the very, very, very wonderful and amazing Reverend Lori Idahosa. You're welcome, madam. Ladies and gentlemen, we have a lot and a lot and a lot and a lot of our guests who are seated. As time goes on, we'll definitely make a lot of recognitions.
All right. With that verbal mention, acknowledgement done, allow us to say all dignitaries present, political office holders from governors, past governors, Senate reps, all dignitaries, representatives of the diplomatic corps, leaders of thought, captains of industry, doyens, you are all welcome, distinguished ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for making our time to join us in this service of songs for Captain Idahosa Wells Okubo. Thank you. Please put your hands together for yourselves.
No, that's yourself you're clapping for. Please put your hands together for yourselves. Now, typically in these events, everybody would like to get a word in. Everybody would like to say something about the dearly departed. Unfortunately, we just don't have enough time to hear who he was to each of us. So you'll permit us to just select a handful of people to speak. Through the course of the evening, you'll be watching video presentations, hearing tributes from his children, grandchildren, and a few dear friends about him. And that will just have to suffice. We will not be welcoming contributions randomly for this particular service of songs. Thank you very much. We ask that also because it's difficult to see all the way from the back that you refrain from standing up unless you must leave or have to use the restroom so that everyone can see all that will go on the stage. Thank you very much. With that said, ladies and gentlemen, we would like to move to the next thing we have to do, which is once more. Bring you some music, but this time something slightly more contemporary in styling. He's known as one of the sexiest men in Nigeria, is good at leading people into the presence of God with his instrument. He is similar to David in that when he blows on his instrument, the Spirit of God does come down. Please join us and welcome B.J. Sax.
Bye.
Thank you so much. Please, I think he deserves a better round of applause, BJ Sauce. And so, Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, just a moment ago, he walked in with his very, very delectable wife. Join me as we welcome a two-time governor of our neighboring state, Delta State. Please put your hands together for Chief James Onanefe Ibori and his beautiful wife. Thank you for coming, Your Excellency. I also would like to recognize and welcome another very wonderful friend of the family. Please put your hands together for Mr. and Mrs. Gideon Mokere. You're welcome, sir. Thank you so much for coming. May I also recognize all the way from Abuja, our own Apostle Goodheart Ekweme. You're welcome, Apostle. Thank you so much. In that same vein, I also like to welcome Apostle Charles Osazua. Thank you so much for coming.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, please turn your attention to the multimedia screens for a tribute video from Friends of Captain.
Captain Okumbo was a great entrepreneur.
A proud son of Nigeria and a flag bearer for his beloved Edo State.
Captain was humanity personified.
Captain was unique in so many respects.
Man of many parts.
A man with integrity.
One of the nicest men I've met in my life.
He became a solution provider.
He's a combination of a lot of things.
I'm still shocked at this moment, devastated when I heard about the shock news. And I wish it was spared to enjoy the hard work. But we cannot query God.
I go into introspection since he died. So I imagine moments when he's talking and I'm watching. When he's talking to me, talking to people, I watch.
I knew he was ill, but somehow I was hoping that God was going to do a miracle. I really had faith that God was going to do a miracle and he would come back home alive. As a matter of fact, I planned to go visit him in September, but he did not wait for me.
The death of Katulosa is still a shock to me. I only knew him for 2 years, but the lasting memory I have, it's as if I've known him for 20 years.
I would describe my father as a devoted father, a responsible man, a man with integrity, a man that showcased the greatest of virtues, which is service to God and service to humanity, a man with a great heart, and who allowed his heart to be used by God for the service of the greater good.
I remember him for everything that I cannot even describe here. Okay, protected me and was always selfless in everything. I'm not surprised at what he became in life, because right from when he didn't even have anything, he has always been selfless. He has always put himself, you know, last before any other person. He's always happy to see your problem solved.
The man that was pleading for peace, asking for peace, and Captain cannot be forgotten. He will be indelible in the minds of so many.
I can only remember him to be a humble man, unassuming man, sincere person, truthful person, dependable person, and this is the way I will always remember him.
I must say,
that when I did meet him, I understood why people called him Captain. And that's, I think, reflected the fact that he was very much a leader.
With all his achievements as a successful businessman, Captain Hoster remained a humble man and never lost his humanity.
Let me say this, Captain was humanity personified. When I say humanity, it was everything good in a human being.
From the time I met him till today, I've never found anybody say that Captain Hoster did A or B or C to him, no. Every time, anybody that you meet, you will hear that one, Captain Hoster and I were friends and he did A, B, C, D to me.
As a young man, one thing that I would want to say about him, which I noticed very well, is his thing for perfection. He has always wanted to do things correctly.
Is someone who easily forgives. Well, a lot of people don't understand him. Very lovely guy.
I don't know who had problem that Captain knew about that he wouldn't want to try to help.
I was fortunate to know Captain and to count him as a friend.
Captain will not look at you based on your tribe. Captain will not look at you based on your religion. Captain wouldn't look and deal with you based on where you come from. Captain will not even look at you and deal with you based on your conduct. He deals with you, relates with you as a human being.
There's so many words I can use to describe my elder brother, but the one that sticks the most to me is the man with the biggest heart.
Come on, I think we can put our hands together for the man that we're here to celebrate today. I believe we've done a very decent round of greetings in terms of protocol and acknowledgements. This kind of event is truly a state event. If you came into the state today, you would see that the streets, the buildings, everywhere, the lampposts are just replete with pictures of Captain. And so the whole state is in mourning. There are going to be dignitaries coming through to this service throughout the evening. What will not happen is that we will continue to acknowledge people as they arrive. So I beg your indulgence that you just accept that we have closed all greetings to dignitaries from this moment. We see you, we appreciate you, but we choose from this moment to celebrate the man and his family only. We have done our best. In that vein, I'd like to quickly acknowledge his family. We have saved them for last because I want your applause to be different for them. Please put your hands together for Captain's family, his wife, Nosa Okumbo, his children. I can't name all 12 of you, so I'll just name first Olori Atuashe III, wife of Ogiame Atuashe III, Olofori, and Mr. Osaho Okumbo, and all the siblings. We see you. We love you guys. Come on, put your hands together for them. Let them know that daddy may be gone, but you are still here and you are in support of their lives. Thank you. Good to see you guys.
Okay, Your Excellency, ladies and gentlemen, please, before we bring the next person on stage, I would like to beg, if you're the owner of this vehicle, Toyota Color, Ash Color, with registration number BEN408MS. I'll go about that again. Toyota Corolla, Ash Color, BEN408MS. I've been informed that your car is on and then is smoky. Please go and check. You brought your car here as a Corolla. You don't know the number. Just go and check, please. This is when we'll bring on stage the immediate younger brother of Capitano to come and give his tribute. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for Sir Kingsley Okumbo as he comes on stage to give his tribute.
I'll see you again. Tears may fall. I know you're with God. I know it is well. I'll dry my eyes. I'll remember your smile. I know it is well.
Good evening, brothers and sisters. Thank you for making it easier for me to stand on existing protocols. Good evening once again. Let me, on behalf of the family, welcome everyone to this beautiful occasion in memory of my brother. I've just been told I have 5 minutes, so I'll try to be very brief because I want to believe I'm one of those that have known him the least in this hall for only 59 years. How do I give a tribute or eulogy to a brother that will never, most of the time, introduce me by my name? Anytime he sees me, he says, "This is my brother who I gave my mother's breast to when I was done." I grew up to know my brother, today known as Captain Hosa, as Brother Ida Hosa. And I would like to spell that brother. It was B-R-O-A-O-D-A. You dare not call him by his name, because by the kind of home we're raised, you have to revere your seniors. I grew up to know basically 4 people as a child: my father, my mother, my senior brother, Dr. T, and Brother Ida Hosa. Words fail me at times like this because the pain has really been deep. I was there with the children. We saw it all. We grieved together. We laughed together. We danced together. We prayed together. But I'm consoled by the fact that my brother, Ida Hosa Wells Okumbo, is in heaven. I thank God for the life that you lived, my dear brother. You came and defined the concept that there are times that one tree can make a forest if it's big enough and has more than enough branches to give refuge to everyone. Everybody has spoken about how philanthropic he is. I'm not surprised. Just like I said in the tributes, when I was a child, and I've told him this before, even during his birthday, I said the biggest amount he has ever given me in life is 10 naira. I was a child in government college. He had my back. He was in Federal Government College, Warri. And when I needed money most, you can imagine my school fees of 30 naira that was sufficient enough for me to have provisions, feeding, books for a whole term. My brother sent me 10 naira from Zaria. And like I said, from his sick bed, because he had an accident on a motorbike. And the grace of God has always been on my brother's life. Engineer Tito, an electrical engineer, is right there in the hall. There has never been anyone in flying school in Zaria that had an accident and was not resuscitated. The grace of God has always been upon his life. I recall what he said, that somebody that was even playing football for the school had an accident and he was rusticated. Captain got an accident with a bike, and his instructors and students were doing night vigil to ensure that he was not rusticated. That is the grace that has been on his life. My brother, to say I will miss you is just an understatement. Who will now call me and say, "Oteme, Oteme, Oteme"? As we speak, I have not told my mom. I've tried to be politically correct anytime she asks about him. But God will give us grace to deal with it. I can write a book on him. This is hard for me. Very, very hard. Well, let me say this. Everybody says Captain is very generous. I agree. But he was very selfish with one thing. the size of his shoe. That was the only thing as a child I could not get from his wardrobe. His wardrobe was my wardrobe. I dressed in his clothes. I inherited his clothes. He loved me with everything. I'm not sure I was able to give back 80% or even 50% of what he gave to me. I remember the good times we shared, my brother. I remember the good times we shared. Even in your trying moments, I remember the things you told me. I will forever, ever cherish that. Brother Idahosa, it is well with you. Brother Idahosa, it is well with you. You know, Captain, some people don't know how funny it can be. My only regret was the fact that I couldn't get him to play golf. You know, because most times I will ask him, I say, you're working too hard. Please play golf, Captain. And I can bet you I bought over 5 golf sets for him. And you know what he would tell me? He would say, Kingsley, don't worry. When I have enough money like you, I'll play golf. Until I virtually dragged him to the golf course. My deputy governor here knows what I'm talking about. My brother and my friend, you are heaven's gain. I love you. I love you. I love you. Please permit me to sing this little song. And please don't mind my dressing. I'm not a rabbi. I was trying to be spiritual because if you were here yesterday, you see that it was very cold. So I tried to put this on to be able to kill that, you know, if it happens again today. But having said that, please join me, but just let me sing this song briefly. My brother, where you are, you are loved more than how you loved people. I will never forget what you told me. You said, my brother, never do evil. If you cannot do good, stay neutral. I will cherish that. Say hello to Paddy Man, as we call our dad. Say hello to Grandma. It is well with you, my brother. It is well. It is well. It is well. And please permit me to stand, and I'll face the audience with the family my brother has left me with. Thank you very much. God bless you.
Please put your hands together. A heartfelt tribute, no doubt. Ladies and gentlemen, over the course of the evening, a few people will be speaking. It is completely impossible to sum up an individual's life in a few minutes. So we've left you with a strong, strong task. A very strong task. Family stands strong together, ladies and gentlemen. Your Kumbo name stands strong and lives on. The values not departing
The integrity staying strong.
Voice is very sonorous, so I want her to take that.
Kingdom, we are family, we are one, we are one, we are heirs of the Father. We are joint heirs with the Son. We are children of the kingdom.
We are family. We are one more time.
Thank you.
Your joint hands with the sun.
Thank you. Right. Okay. Uncle, I'm going to have to ask you that you take the family back to sit down. Otherwise, you will attract people to join, and I don't want anyone touching the family today. Gentlemen of the press, please don't get too close. And if you're not wearing a face mask, don't be there at all. This is family reuniting, standing strong together. This is healing going on right now. Totally unscripted. I believe that right there was the Spirit of God, ladies and gentlemen. Healing wounds, bringing the family together. In the midst of pain. Pressmen, please don't get so close. And if you're not wearing a face mask, pressmen, please don't be there.
This isn't farewell. I'll see you again.
Security, if you would be so kind as to help me remove the pressmen from in front of the family. Forcefully, if necessary. Thank you. Thank you. Stop the music for a second. Stop the music. That was a very personal, private moment of the family. When things like this happen, when there's a loss in the family, for some unfortunate families, it separates siblings, your uncles, you know, but for a family that is blessed like this one, it brings them together. That was a very private moment, and that moment of healing may continue to expand. May God continue to hold you strong together. The bond that ties you together may never be broken in Jesus' name. Having said that, I'm going to very deliberately caution our pressmen. This is not one of those Lagos events. where you jump in front of people to take pictures. It's not Bogboiro. It's not one of those type of sets up. So please, I don't want any pressman to come in front of the family again. Security, please ensure that that does not repeat itself. Right? We're living in the midst of something that is very serious. That cannot happen again. Pressmen, we will consider you a threat to our family and to the dignitaries present if you repeat that. Thank you very much. Having said that, I was going to go straight to the first reading, but I'd like to give our reader a moment to compose herself. And instead, I will bring up a singer. He's a soloist with a classical orientation. He has sung to presidents and in about 7 countries around the world. He's no newcomer to stage. Please make welcome Frank the Tenor. Please put your hands together for him.
I really have to show you, I am so glad I know you. Now we are saying goodbye, I'm not ashamed to cry, but God knows the reason why you have to leave. I don't know why you must move on. I don't know why, although you'd be gone, you stay with me eternally, and wherever you I wish I'd felt you stronger. You got so much out of life. That's why you were able to give. That's why you were able to live a life with love. I don't know why. You have to leave, and I will grieve, but I wish you my best, 'cause that's what you gave, and that's what will last. I don't know why fate is unfair. Why they need you up there? You have
Cause that's what you gave, Captain. And that's what will last. I see you, Captain.
Thank you very much, Mr. Frank Tenner. Very nicely done. Next up, we will take our first scripture reading. It will be taken from Ecclesiastes 3, verse 1 to 12. And to do the reading, please welcome Olori Atuashe III, first child of Captain Osa. She takes the reading.
Good evening, everyone. And so I read Ecclesiastes 3, 1 to 12. To everything there is a season, and a time to every purpose under the heaven, a time to be born, and a time to die, a time to plant, and a time to pluck up that which is planted, a time to kill, and a time to heal, a time to break down, and a time to build up, a time to weep, and a time to laugh, a time to mourn, and a time to dance, a time to cast away stones, and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace, and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to get, and a time to lose, a time to keep, and a time to cast away, a time to rend, and a time to sow, a time to keep silence, and a time to speak, a time to love, and a time to hate, a time to war, and a time of peace. What profit hath he that worketh in that wherein he laboreth? I have seen the travail which God hath given to the sons of men to be exercised in it. He hath made everything beautiful in his time. Also, he hath set the world in their hearts, so that no man can find out the work that God maketh from the beginning till the end. I know that there is no good in them, but for a man to rejoice and to do good in his life. May God bless the reading of his word.
Ladies and gentlemen, another round of applause for Her Royal Majesty Atuwoshe III, the wife of the Oluwabwe. At this point, ladies and gentlemen, from a daughter to a granddaughter, can we just please stay glued to our screen as we get a tribute presentation from Captain's granddaughter, Shemaye Emiko.
Grandpa, I miss you and I love you. I know you're with Jesus in heaven right now. What I miss most about him, he buys me toys, and whenever I come to his house and when I tell him to buy me a toy, he will always buy me a toy. Thank you, Grandpa, for buying me so many toys. I love you, Grandpa, and you're the best grandpa of all grandpa.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, we'll take a hymn, It Is Well With My Soul. One would think that with all the things that Captain had to do and how busy he was, he might have been one of those men who didn't have time for family, but the reverse is the case. through all the generations of his family, the older, the contemporaries, the younger, and the grandchildren. All of them have a personal story about Captain. Please join us and appreciate the choir. That particular song, that particular hymn was written by a Christian hymnist who had lost his son in a fire. He had lost his son in a fire, and grieving with his family, he decided to send the family off to England. Unfortunately for him, The ship his family was on sunk. His four daughters died in that ship, and leaving his wife alone. But in the midst of all that pain, having lost five children in quick succession, he still found space to worship God. And he said, "It is well with my soul." There's something powerful about praising God through your pain. Please turn your attention to the multimedia screens.
There's only one place in the Bible the Lord taught us how to pray, which is the Lord's Prayer. And it's very short. But a lot of people don't understand it. But it's the most powerful prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
He did demonstrate that you don't have to be in government to impart on life of people. Now, a lot of people will talk about Captain, billionaire businessman. That is not what makes him unique. It is the heart.
Captain has changed a lot of people's lives. He has made a lot of people you see around him today, they were all made by Captain.
It's not just only a loss to me. I call it my destiny. Katuosa did so much to me. He made things, the things that look impossible in this earth, made it a reality for me. Gave me a platform to rise. Gave me a platform to know that hard work really pays. I'm going to miss that father-son relationship.
Captain Idahosa Ogumbo came to this earth to put smiles in the lives of many and to share, you know, in areas where they are having challenges. And he was a giver, not just a giver, but someone that derives joy and fulfillment when he gives to people.
There is nothing that you want to succeed that he wouldn't give you. So I would describe Captain as an enigma, yet a father.
He's a man of integrity. I give that to him. I always tell people around that if there's one thing I've loved around Captain that I cannot take away from him, is his integrity when dealing with people. I still feel a huge sense of loss because Captain is certainly irreplaceable. Captain has touched lives. He's not the kind of person that kept his words to himself. He took delight in touching life and helping others.
I work with him day in, day out. You know, before you wake up, you know, the first person that will see is me. So, and me, myself, when I wake up, the first person I will see is Captain Idahosa West Okumbo.
Like I said to him in his final hours, I said, "Daddy, I will keep your legacy going." And I believe all of us, his children, have that intention to live for more than just ourselves, to live for purpose. Looking back at the life of my father, that was what he did. He lived for purpose. He did not live to make money. He lived to impact his world around him.
But we should take consolation that what matters at the end of it is what has he left behind by which we'll remember him. Let's wipe our tears and praise ourselves and do something that when he looks down and sees, he would say, "Yes, he started well. Those he has left behind are running well with what he has left." There's no better than this.
He will indeed be missed by many, not only in his community, but many across the nation, including me, because of the impactful friendship and relationships he cultivated while alive.
The greatest consolation we have is that Captain lived a good life. So what I owe Captain now, I owe him two things. One, to pay my last respect to him. Two, to continue to pray to God to reward him for the life he lived. Thirdly, to use everything available to me to take care of what he has left behind, both human and material.
There are too many things. Put it to him. I was at a function. Somebody said, Katosa, you dominated the air. You dominated the sea. You dominated land. Okay, what else?
I will miss that safety, you know, that he's provided for us. And that safety is for you to succeed, for you to be all that you can be.
And if there's any message I think we should get out of this, anyone you know, you can show love, show it to them while they are alive. Show it to them while they are with you. Let them know how well they are loved. If you see what everyone is saying about him, nobody came to say, oh, maybe the finest wristwatch, I saw it in his hand, the finest car, I saw him driving. Those are not the things that people are talking about. Everybody's talking about how well he gave, how well he showed love. That means life is more about giving than receiving.
All this is all praise. But when you praise God, you bring forth his presence.
Hallelujah.
And when you bring forth his presence, God already knows everything that you need. Because he knows your beginning and your end.
Ladies and gentlemen, at the beginning of the video, I'm sure we paid attention to where Captain was praying the Lord's Prayer. And for those of us who know, the Lord's Prayer starts with Our Father, who art in heaven. Permit me to say that from now, of course, when the children pray the Lord's Prayer and they say, Our Father, who art in heaven, I think I'll read their minds when they say, Our Father to God Almighty, and then Our Father to Captain Osa Wells Okumba. This is the point where I need to bring the first son of Captain Dr. Wells Osa Okumba to have the second scripture reading from the book of Isaiah, chapter 57, from verse 1. To two. Please put your hands together for Osahon Okumba.
No. How do I start to tell the world your story? How do I write this beautiful journey?
The righteous perisheth. And no man layeth it to heart. And merciful men are taken away, none considering that the righteous is taken away from the evil to come. He shall enter into peace. They shall rest in their beds, each one walking in his uprightness. Blessed be the word of the Lord.
Thank you, Mr. Osahon. Next, I'm going to be inviting twin boys. Ladies and gentlemen, as they come, I want you clapping like you've seen rock stars or footballers to give a tribute to their father. Ladies and gentlemen, please make welcome Ryan and Brian Okumba. Big applause. It's not an easy feat for them to do this, so I want you to really appreciate them as they come.
I love him a lot. I love Daddy. Daddy always called us his little toys. I remember all of those times that he called us his little toys. He was a great man. I miss him. I wish he was still here today.
You can do a lot better than that with the applause. Honestly, you can. This is the trying time for these young men, and they need to know that you'll be in their corner. So I want you to show them with your round of applause. That is not a small thing at all, to lose the father. Young men, look around the room. Look around the room, look beside you, look behind you. All these people stand for you, right? They stand for you and they will be in your corner. And God will see to it that you don't feel the weight of the man that you have lost. He will be strength to you, father to the fatherless, in Jesus' name. I would like to welcome another one of his children. And I want you to keep that energy going. As you can see, this is a trying time. I want them to feel courage from you. I want them to be encouraged by you. Please make welcome Omosede Okumbo. Keep the applause going. Strong. Strong. Please.
Where you continue to fly. A place where your spirit never dies. This isn't farewell.
Sorry. I'm just trying to get my thingy open. Dear Daddy, I've been so scared to write this because it feels like a goodbye letter. But it is not, because you'll forever be with me and a part of my big heart. I guess this is my second tribute to you. And it hurts that I have to write this because I miss you every day. I still don't think I can comprehend that you are no longer with us, because you were such a big and amazing presence in this world. You inspired me in ways I don't even think you know. You pushed me every day of my life. Sometimes I never understand why you did so, and it's sad that I finally understand when you are not present anymore. You wanted me to be the best version of myself, and I would try everything in my being to do so. I am so blessed and thankful to have been graced with a father like you. You cared about all of us so much. Every day I would be told by external sources how much you loved us, and I think about it all the time now. I think about how much each and every one of your children holds a big space in your heart. I hurt when I think about you, but you didn't want us to be sad. So I try every day not to be. And I try to think about all the good traits you had, like how caring you were, generous, and deep down loving. I would always say that your love language was gift-giving. But from being here, I can see how beneficial your expression of love was to the world. I can see that it has touched so many people's lives in so many ways. Probably 2 years ago, I don't think I could comprehend how giving to others could impact so many people's lives. But being here for 2 days had made me understand that he didn't just give, but he gave with all the love he had. I am so proud of all the things you did and who you were as a person. I know you had a great big good heart. I want you to be just as proud of me as I am of you. I want you to smile in heaven, and when you see me, you think I'm so proud of Omos. From the littlest things, like helping someone in need, because some people would experience an issue at hand in the world and think they can't make a difference as an individual. But my father wasn't a bystander, and neither would I be. I don't know what I'm going to do next 23rd of July, not getting a call from you at 12 a.m. with you singing, "Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you." I was one of the last of your children that you spent my birthday with. And we didn't do much because of COVID. But that will go down as one of my favorite birthdays ever, because nothing can compare to hanging out with you and hearing that song and watching those compilation videos, even though you would sneakily ask everyone for me to send you pictures. I would try my best to be able to give you, to give the love you gave to others. What keeps me going is knowing that you are happy and at peace. I'm glad I wrote this, and in a way it brings me comfort, reminding myself of how incredible you were and how okay you are right now. So I don't have to worry about you. I'll focus to better myself and make you proud. I love and will always love you, always and forever, from your only Moss Moss.
How do I start to tell the world your story? How do I write this?
I think we can do better by giving them a better round of applause. Ladies and gentlemen, the third scripture reading will be done by Osaruense Okumbo, and this is from the book of Philippians chapter 1, from verse 21 to 23. Osaruense.
To me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. But if I live in the flesh, this is the fruit of my labor. Yet what I shall choose, I wot not. For I am in a strait betwixt two, having a desire to depart and to be with Christ, which is far better. Thank you.
And next up, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Esohe Okumbo to say a few words about her father.
Many things I could say about my father, and I'm going to address him personally from here on. I could talk about the countless things he said and did for us, your family, but today I just want to thank you for being such a good father and for giving me a role model to aspire after. I love you so dearly, Daddy. Continue to rest in heaven and in peace. And now you've joined the angels above me that will continue to protect me for the rest of my life. I love you once again and see you when the time is right. Mwah, mwah, as I used to end the phone call. I miss you, your darling princess, your cho-cho, your little girl. Thank you.
Thank you, Esohe. Please put your hands together for her properly. You have no idea, for most of you in the whole, what it is to lose a parent at this stage of your life. It is not an easy thing. We're going to go quickly to a word of exhortation. But before we get to the word of exhortation, I'm going to welcome a gentleman to lead us in some music, some worship. He is one of Nigeria's younger singers in terms of his age, but in his accomplishments, he has done pretty well for himself. Ladies and gentlemen, please make welcome Peter. He'll be singing the theme song, I beg your pardon, for this event, Hosan Never Dies. Please put your hands together for Peter.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Joshua 1:9, be strong and take courage. Do not fear or be dismayed, for the Lord will go before you. This was a thought in my head when I penned down the song. And this is a call for everyone who's here celebrating. The memories of our father will live on forever.
Yeah.
a home in the sky, far above the deep blue horizon, where you continue to fly, a place where you live and never die. These seasons farewell, I'll see you again. Good men never die. No, they don't know. How do I start to tell about your story? How do I write this beautiful journey? Yeah. Words are not enough. There's no time at all. This season's farewell. I'll see you again. Tears may fall, I know you're with God, I know it is well. I'll dry my eyes, I'll remember your smile, I know it is well. Tears well, you gave your all, and you answered the call, I know it is well. Oh, this season farewell, yeah. I'm gonna see you again. Tears may fall, I know you're with God, I know it is well. I'll dry my eyes, I'll remember.
Amen. Shall we pray? Father in heaven, we sincerely thank you. We truly bless and we glorify your name. And we thank you for 63 years of a life well lived, 63 years of a heart that didn't stop beating, 63 years of hard work, results, progress, peace, and joy. 63 years of achievement, 63 years of fruitfulness. Please accept our thanks in the name of Jesus Christ, because the Bible says that in all things we should give thanks. So we thank you for this life of your son, Idahosa Wells Okumbo. We thank you for all the things that he did. We thank you for the things that he failed to do. We thank you for everything. Please accept my thanks in Jesus' name. Please speak through me tonight. Words that will comfort the family, that will strengthen them, and bless your people. In the name of Jesus Christ. And let there be love and unity in the family, peace and progress in our nation. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen. I'd like to thank the family for asking me to speak tonight at my brother's farewell. I want to thank my dear sister Nosa and all the wonderful people and women associated with my brother. I truly want to thank you for giving him peace, for giving him joy, and for being there for him at various times. And of course, the children led by the Olori and Osahon. My prayer is that you will keep the family together and that you strengthen the family. My brothers, Dr. T. Kingsley, Bright, and Tantison, the Lord will strengthen you all in Jesus' name. I chose those two songs for Hosa. And the first one was a song that was made very popular by one of the best singers of all time. And it simply says, I did it my way. I did it my way. Now it's time to go. I've looked around, I've seen the highway. But at the end of it all, I did it my way. Because it epitomizes the kind of life that Hosa lived. And the second one, Yoruba song, very popular also, that talks about the frailty of life, the uselessness of life, the ordinariness of life, if we don't make it to heaven. Ecclesiastes chapter 8, verse 8a, says there's no man that hath power over the spirit to retain the spirit. Neither does any man have any power in the day of death. It says death is a war, and there's no discharge in that war. Neither will wickedness deliver those who are given to it. I never thought that today will come, because Hosa was larger than life. And you tend to think that people like that never die, that they just go on living and living and living. But as scripture says, no man born of a woman has power to retain the spirit. As a pastor, you tend to witness many things. And over time, you tend to recognize when people are about to go. And then you begin to see the discussion and the struggles. Some are saying, fire, 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 pain. There's tears running down their eyes. And others are saying, death, bring it on, bring it on, bring it on. I'm ready to go, bring it on. But at the end of the day, there's that final breath. That final breath. That final breath. And it's generally all over. And then you realize that none of us has that power over that season of death. And that we're all gradually walking towards that time, whether we like it or not. Because there's no discharge in that war. So my sister Nossa, I feel for you. And you know that I know that I know that I know how you feel. I know how you feel. Because I have been there before. It's not how long, but how well. And death is extremely powerful. And it can teach us a few things. Number one, one day, definitely, it will be our own turn. Sooner than or later, it will be our own turn. About 6 months or 9 months ago, a gentleman died. And one of the big bishops of the faith came to speak in my church concerning the gentleman. And when he finished speaking, he and I chatted. And that was the last time I saw him, only for me to hear 4 or 5 weeks ago that he had passed. Because one day or the other, it will soon be our turn. When my wife died 1 year, 3 months, and a few days ago, I suddenly realized that you begin to live life backwards. You live life backwards. Because it is only at the end of life that you will understand life. And what life really means. And when and what it has done for you. The second thing that we learn about death is that some people are impossible to forget. Some people are impossible to forget. I believe my brother Osa will be one of those. And I want to charge the children to never forget their father. 2 weeks before my wife died, she suddenly took a trip to Ibadan to look for the graveyard of her father who had died about 18 years before. And for some strange reason, she took a video of that trip. And when she got to the graveyard in Songo in Ibadan, she couldn't recognize her father's grave. The place was overgrown with weeds and the place was untidy, so they had to be cutting through the place to get to where she was. And it was her moment of repentance, her moment of reconnection, her moment of apology to her dad for having forgotten him or his place of rest this last 18 years. Never let that happen to your dad. Make sure that you keep his memory alive. I was with a lady a couple of weeks ago who had lost her husband about a year ago. And we're talking generally about the vanity of life and sharing experiences. And she said to me, "I don't know about you, but I can never forget my husband." She says, "I still go every day to where his clothes are and I put on his favorite perfume." And I was trying to be a macho pastor, and I didn't comment. If only she knew that every day I went to my wife's wardrobe also and smelt her clothes. There was this socks that she wore a couple of days before she died. Every morning I would smell those socks just to encourage myself. Some people are impossible to forget. The third is that death picks his own choices and decides who it wants to take. As scripture says, there's no discharge in that war, and no one has power over death. Death will leave the old and take the young. Death will leave the rich and take the poor. Or death will leave the poor and take the rich. My cousin died many, many years ago. And when I went to look for his body in the mortuary in Oshobo, and by the way, the mortuary is somewhere we all must visit. So that those of us who are here will understand the vanity of life. Vanity upon vanity, all is vanity, says the preacher.
My mother-in-law says all houses are for sale. That big, huge house that you built, that you cherish, that wonderful car that you bought, that you love, those clothes that you have bought and bought and bought and bought and bought and bought, the jewelry that you've amassed all over the place, you suddenly realize that nothing belongs to you. Nothing belongs to you. Nothing belongs to you. If you don't sell your house in your lifetime, your son will sell it. If your son doesn't sell it, your grandson will sell it. If your grandson doesn't sell it, your great-grandson will sell it. Because all houses are for sale. And it brought to me the reality of life and the frailty of life. Death picks its own and decides on who it's going to take. And this time, fortunately, unfortunately, he has taken one of the very best. But one thing you should know, it is that it is the best tree in the garden that is first of all taken. When my wife died, Pastor Tony Rappu came to share a word in our church and told the story of the owner of the rose garden and the guy who was tending the rose garden. And one day he came and he found that the prettiest rose in the garden had been taken away. And this guy was furious and he went to the owner of the rose garden and said, "Somebody has taken away our rose. Somebody has taken away our rose." Only for him to find the owner of the rose garden having breakfast, and the rose that had been taken away was there in the water pot in front of him, because the owner will take his own. Death chooses who he takes. The fourth and the most important thing is that there are lessons to be learned from each life. What are the lessons that I learned from my brother Osa's life? Number one, in life you must be visionary. The Bible says that without a vision, people do not behave well. Osa was visionary. He crossed seas and charted waters that nobody dared to chart. Started business when a lot of us were not thinking about business. In life, you must look ahead, know your purpose in life and where your life is going, and walk diligently towards it. Don't just live life as one of the boys or just one of the girls for material things, because if you don't have vision or priority, you lose focus. If you don't know which way your life is going, it may not end well. My prayer for you today is like my brother Hosa, you would have vision and a direction for your life so that by the time you get there, you know you have gotten there. Hosa was hardworking and determined and courageous. He wasn't a lazy man. He took his bit in life and he walked towards it. And he was determined to succeed. If you are not determined to succeed in life, if you don't stand for something, you may fall for everything. If you are going to work, work hard. Look at the future in the face and determine to get there. And we need courage in Nigeria this time when we need to determine where our leadership is going. The third thing about Osa, and I'll finish in a few minutes, is that he was generous and accommodating. Generous and accommodating. And one of the best things that you can do for life and do for yourself and do for posterity is the ability to give. The ability to make sure that people are comfortable and people are well. The ability to know that whatever has been put in your care has been put in your care for the benefit of others. A lot of us here are a little bit stingy. A lot of us here think only of ourselves first. And the Bible says that one of the criteria for making it to heaven, one of the criteria for making it to heaven is the ability to sell all you have, give it to the poor, and then you'll have treasures in heaven. Sell all you have, give it to the poor, you'll have treasures in heaven. I preached this message to a group of elderly gentlemen, And as I was preaching to them, they were shifting on their feet, shifting on their feet. I said, you have 20 houses, you have 30 houses. What are you doing with it at the age of 83? Sell it, give it to the poor. Sell it, give it to the poor. Then you will have treasures in heaven. They looked at me just like so. I said, there's nothing you are going to take away from here. Nothing you are going to take away from here. But Osa was extremely generous. About 2-3 years ago, Majek Fashek walked to me in church. Just walked to me in church and said he needed help. And I was putting myself together to help him and see what to do with him. He says, by the way, do you know a man called Captain Osa? I said, yes, he's my brother. Call him. Thank him for me. Thank him for me. When I was sick, he paid my medical bills, housed me in London, made sure I was okay. He spent over 40,000 or 50,000 pounds on my sake. So I called Osa. I said, Osa, now so you do. He said, no, mind my Jeff, I said, I don't tell him, I say, make you leave that thing. You know, leave him. So I said, okay, make I try, make I sort him out. Anything you get, make you do, make you help him. Unfortunately, my Jeff went, and now Osa has gone, saying that death decides on who he takes. Another thing I need to thank Osa for was that he gave my late wife her very first job at Hosni. So I want to thank you, Hosa, wherever you are, for giving Ibiduni a hope and an expectation in life. And that which she learned on that platform saw her through life. And she had direct access to Hosa at any time, in spite of the fact that she had worked for him almost 20 years before. So I want to thank you, his children. Thank his wife. Thank you all who are here for a man who gave opportunity to others. If you are not too tired and too weak, I want you to give a round of applause. A round of applause. A standing ovation. A standing ovation for an outstanding man, an extraordinary man, a wonderful man, a thoughtful man, a kind man, a generous man, a man worthy to be associated with, and a man who loved everyone that he saw. Come on, let's give the Lord another round of applause. Please be seated as I close. Four things you must have, no matter who you are. People who truly love you. Friends who care about you. Progress in business. And a welcoming home. But the most important thing you must have in life is a desperate relationship with God. A deep and a passionate relationship with God. Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 1 to 8 says, remember your Creator in the days of your youth, before the evil days come. A lot of us in the days of our youth make grave mistakes. We don't look for God in time. We think God is boring, old-fashioned, and doesn't have time for us. But in spite of all that we think, I want to tell you that we serve a gracious God, a beautiful God, a wonderful God, a delightful God, a God who cares, and a God who wants you to succeed. The Bible says that God is not a wicked God, that he wants anybody to die and to perish. But God is kind and gracious, waiting for us all to repent, so that he can give us a chance in heaven. I know, like me, Hosa played the field. We played the field together in Lagos. Hosa chased the girls. We chased the girls together in Lagos. Hosa did the parties. We did the parties together in Lagos. And then one day, a dawn of realization came to me, and I said, I've done all that I can do. Let me go and do God. And I went and I began to do God, and I started talking to all my friends. Please come. I have found the peace that passeth all understanding. I have found the peace that women cannot give. I have found the peace that money cannot give. I have found the peace that pride cannot give. I have found the peace that power cannot give. I have found the peace that life cannot give. I have found the peace that only God can give. Only God can give. Only God can give. Only God. I said, I'm not coming back to brandy. I'm not coming back to champagne. I'm not coming back to parties. I'm not coming back to hangovers. I'm not coming back to fear. I'm not coming back to anxiety. I am going forward with Jesus Christ. I say, I'm not coming back. 35 years on, I'm not coming back. 5 years on, God is still working in my life. 35 years on, I will not fail. So I went round to all my friends and I started begging them. And a lot of them were laughing at me. But eventually they started laughing with me. Because when they got into a jam with their wives, they'll come to me. When they got to a jam in their businesses, they'll come to me. When they got to a jam in their finances, they'll come to me. One good thing about Osa was that towards the end, he found God. He found God. You could hear him preaching the Lord's Prayer, telling us what the Lord's Prayer stands for, and is the most beautiful prayer, the most powerful prayer you can ever think of. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Hosea got sick. And sometimes we are worried, we are angry that we got sick. But you see, we serve a beautiful God who sees the end from the beginning from the end, and all that's in between. And he sometimes gives you sickness so that you can have time to set your house in order and prepare to meet your Maker. It's a privilege. Let's not look back in worry. Let's not look back in anger. Let's look forward in thanksgiving and gratitude to God for taking one of his own. I want to assure you, children, that he shall be well with you. The Lord will strengthen you. The Lord will be with you. The Lord will compensate you. The Lord will guide you. The Lord will make his face to shine upon you. And I want to say, he shall be well with you. My sister Nosa, you will not fail. You will not be put to shame. God will stand by you. He will encourage you. And whenever they hear you and they hear your name, all the good work, all the favor that your husband left behind will be yours in Jesus' name. God will stand by each and every one of us, and it shall be well with our souls. Shall we bow down our heads for a few minutes and talk to Jesus Christ? All heads are bowed, all eyes are closed. I want you to spend a few minutes tonight, just looking over your own life and thinking about your own life. Are you in the right place? Are you doing the right thing? Is your life right with God? Are you sure that when the call is sounded, you'll answer here in heaven? If you are not sure, I'd like to pray with you. If you're not sure that you'll make it to heaven, I'd like to pray with you. If you're not sure of the kind of life that you're living, I'd like to pray with you. If you're not satisfied with where you found yourself, I'd like to pray with you. If you want God to come into your life and turn your situation around, I'd like to pray with you. If you want to confess to God all that you have done, that you shouldn't have done, I'd like to pray with you. So if you want to give your life to Jesus Christ, you want to be born again, now that all heads are bowed, all eyes are closed, I just want you to touch your heart with your right hand, wherever you are, and say this quick prayer after me. Father, I come to you tonight. I ask, Lord, that you forgive my sins. I ask, Lord, that you turn my life around. I ask, Lord, that you give me a second chance. And I decree, Lord, that it shall be well with me. In the name of the Father,
and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Appreciate Pastor Itua Igodalo. Thank you, sir, for a word in season. And now if I could ask you to please turn your attention to the multimedia screens behind me as we bring you a video tribute from Olori Atuashe III.
Okay. Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, as we keep the tributes coming, at this point, permit me to welcome another child of Capitano Osaeme Okumbo to come for her tribute. Please give her a round of applause.
Hello, Daddy, Lani Daddy. Wow, this feels so weird not being able to say this to you over the phone or to your face. Writing this tribute has to be one of the hardest things I have experienced. Never would I have thought that you would leave me so soon. Daddy, you were and still are such a blessing in my life. From the day you brought me into this world,
God knew that you would be such an amazing father and role model in my life. I am so grateful that I don't only look exactly like you, but I also took your generous, loving, giving characters, which I'm proud to have. There are different lessons you have taught me growing up that I can never forget and will forever keep in my heart. Daddy, you were so hardworking. I know most days we couldn't spend time with each other because of how busy you were, but that was because you were sacrificing your time in making my life better through living and education. You never let me down in any aspect of my life, but rather lift me up no matter what. You always taught me to be independent, such as when you took me all the way to China to study. You always taught me to stand out no matter what I do, and never lose focus or join the wrong crowd for people. You have always been my backbone in any difficult situation. We were extremely close. I would call you every day and we would talk for so long. I still can't believe you won't call me next year and many years after to tell me happy birthday and send all your friends and family the videos you always had time to make. Even on your worst days during this illness, you still had time to make my 21st birthday so memorable and amazing. Daddy, I miss you so much, and all I want to do is call and check up on you to know you're fine. The day I found out you had cancer, I genuinely couldn't believe it. You gave me so much strength by fighting so hard. I watched you every day battling with all your power. I felt so upset because you would always call me Mama, as I would always take care of you, but in this instance, I couldn't, but God knows best. 8th of August has to be the worst day of my life. I was robbed of more time with my father. The only father I had was taken away from me. I was robbed from walking down the aisle with my father next to me. Daddy, I wanted you to see me graduate. I only have 2 years left. I wanted you to be by my side. However, one thing I know for sure is that you're resting and you're at peace. I know you're protecting me more now that you're in heaven. I know you're watching over us with a big smile. As much as this is such a sad time, I want you all to know my father lived a great life and touched so many people's hearts. I sincerely thank God for making Captain Udahosa Wells Okumba my father. Daddy, rest well. You're forever and always in my heart. I love you.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, permit me to welcome another child of Captain to come for her own tribute as well. Please put your hands together for Ugogo Okumbo.
Daddy, I'm incapable of counting how many times those words have come out of my mouth, and yet it doesn't seem like they were ever said enough. I can't believe I will never be able to say those words to you again, to see you again, to talk to you again, to hug you again, to tell you I love you just once more. The incapability of hearing your voice again, hearing you call me, go, 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 or sing a very long happy birthday to me deeply disheartens me. I'm left with the echoes you left behind ringing through my head like a constant reminder of the voice that once was. It doesn't seem fair. I kept pushing it away, convincing myself that this cannot be real, convincing myself that if I never think about it, if I constantly distract myself, I will never have to deal with you leaving me. How did I believe such a thing was possible when you played an enormously significant role in my life? I wish we had more time. I wish we spent more time getting to know each other. I wish you were still here. As a father of innumerable children, I understand now that you felt the responsibility to provide for us all, and I will forever appreciate, admire, and be grateful to you for that. I remember when I was younger and I didn't do something I was supposed to do. That day was the first and only time you beat me with a cane. A day or a couple days after, you came to me, sat next to me, apologized to me, and helped me with what I was supposed to have done. I recall this story because no matter how angry you got or how tough you seemed, you always had the kindest, most genuine heart. Your heart glowed of the brightest angelic light, and everyone could see it. You always wanted the best for me and cared for me endlessly, and from that day onwards, I was sure of it. The memory I always go back to is the summer of 2019. The day I got my GCSE exam results was the most special of all days. I remember seeing them and instantly crying into your arms, your smile stretched out willingly from ear to ear. I knew that you were proud of me. I am extremely thankful to have been with you in that moment and to have felt, your overflowing love. It seems inexplicable why when I got my A-level results this summer, I couldn't tell you about it, make you proud just once more. Following the trip to China, we went to Dubai together, and it was just the two of us. I will forever cherish this memory. Being able to spend time with you, just the two of us, taking on Dubai is more special to me than you could ever imagine. I remember ironing your clothes and feeling important, not because you trusted me to do so, but also because I'm sure you could have ironed it yourself, but you were dependent on me to help you. On the way back, you texted me and told me you were missing me and that it was a good time together. It was a great time together, and now I'm the one missing you every day. You are in a long, draining battle fighting against pain and evil, so I'm grateful that what was once an unbearable torture is now an eternal freedom, and what seems like the end of an exceptionally precious life is just the beginning of an eternal, wholesome journey into God's holy kingdom of warmth and kindness. I do not fear because I know you are now in the mightiest, purest, and most powerful hands of all. I know you are soaring high and happily in heaven, and that one day I will see your beautiful smile again. One day I will feel your loving and charismatic energy. We will catch up on everything you missed, and I'll tell you how much I missed you every day. Every unforgiving day that you were meant to be with me on this earth. But for now, please watch over all of us. Please watch over me and protect me from up above. Be present through every failure, every achievement, every laugh, every cry, and every single step of the way. I know you won't have the opportunity to physically see me grow, but I know you will be with me in spirit through it all. On my wedding day, when I have children of my own, when I graduate, and much more. I know you will always be there. I will be successful and change people's lives for the better, like you did, and even more. I will make you proud. You can count on that. I love you forever, Daddy. I didn't say it enough times when you were here. So I love you, I love you, I love you. Goodbye, Daddy. Lani Daddy. Ogogo.
To fly, a place where your spirit never dies.
Beautiful words there, ladies and gentlemen. I want to hear those strong applause. A very strong presentation. Beautiful, beautiful words. And now, ladies and gentlemen, please turn your attention to the multimedia screen for special words from Olori.
Well, one thing keeps recurring through them, and it's how, like I said, how intentional my dad was, how devoted he was to us, his children. When I first went to boarding school in Nigeria, and I'm not going to disclose the boarding school so that they don't get bad reputation. When I first went to boarding school in Nigeria, he came to visit me about a month after I started boarding school, so I was about 12 at that time. And he came to visit me, and I looked absolutely emaciated. I was so skinny. The other students were around, and seeing me, my dad almost started crying. What happened to you? What happened to you? Oh my God, you're so slim. What happened? You know, and like, I couldn't have a father crying in front of everybody. So I kept saying, Daddy, chill. Don't shout. It's okay. And he couldn't contain himself to see that his daughter was a shadow of what she was, you know, when he had brought her in. And that was the level of care. I mean, not up to a few days after that, he called them to take me home, and he fed me fat and made sure I was fine before he released me back into school. And this is just the man that he was, the father that he was. He cared for us with everything that he had. Like I said to him in his final hours, I said, Daddy, I will keep your legacy going. And I believe all of us, his children, have that intention to live for more than just ourselves, to live for purpose. Looking back at the life of my father, that was what he did. He lived for purpose. He did not live to make money. He lived to impact his world around him. He was a great, great, great father. Father like your mother. I miss you, Daddy, and I love you very much.
The family, the Okumbo family, would like to present an award to someone, and I'm going to invite the presenter from the family, Mr. Osaha Okumbo. I'm also going to invite the awardee, Mr. Karim Otuoze, to please join me on the stage. Mr. Karim, please join us on the stage. The applause you hear are well deserved, I assure you. A moment, sir. The Bible says in 2 Chronicles 9:7, happy are thy men, and happy are the people that serve thee. These were the words of the Queen of Sheba. She was speaking about the zeal, diligence, fervor, and joy with which Solomon's servants served him. She had concluded that their loyalty was a reflection and a response to the love that Solomon showed them. Today, though we live in a time where loyalty is scarce and people are self-serving, like Solomon, Captain Idahosa Wells Okumbo's love for those who served him provoked an uncommon loyalty. It is to this end that his family in this occasion has chosen to award Mr. Karim Otuoze with a long service award for over 25 years of dedicated service to their father, Captain Idahosa Wells Okumbo. Karim served Captain for over 25 years, very often being the first and the last face he saw in a day. Karim has traveled the world in the course of his service. Many times, when people couldn't reach Captain, they reached Karim to secure meetings for them. He served diligently, he served with heart, he served with passion. Today, on behalf of the Okumbo family, Mr. Osahon Okumbo presents Mr. Karim Otuoze with an award appreciating his 25 years and more of love, commitment,
and service. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Kareem Otuoze.
Words are not enough. There's no time at all. But this isn't farewell. I'll see you again. Tears may fall. I know you're with God. I know it is well. I'll dry my eyes. I'll remember your smile.
Good evening. Thank you for this award. In short, I'm not prepared for it. It's just a surprise to me. I could have prepared for it very well. So please permit me to call my colleagues to join me. Chidi Mwakuma and Sid Chopra. Sid Chopra. Thank you for everybody that seated here today. My name is Kareem Otuoze, once again. Thank you for this great opportunity for the family of Okumbo that you've given unto me to serve you people, and you accept me in your house. I'm so grateful for this opportunity. And once again, my boss that have given me the opportunity, I thank you, and may you rest in perfect peace in Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. I don't have much to say because I'm not prepared for it. Please, 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 and please, accept me, and please, bear with me for these little things I said to you, God. Because I have many things to say, but you know, it's a very long story for me. I will only thank everybody for coming here to witness the life we are celebrating for the great man, my boss, my mentor, Captain Idahosa West Okumbo. Rest in peace. And rest in peace. God bless you all.
Thank you very much. I think that's a beautiful thing that the family has done. Come on, let's appreciate the family as well for that moment. Choosing to do that here, that is so significant. Now we'll take one more hymn. I want to thank you all for how you have comported yourselves in the course of this. Oh, sure. I want to thank all of you for comporting yourselves so decently in the course of this evening. We are almost there. Just please stay with us and keep your attention on the stage. And as we take this hymn, I'd like to ask that we all rise to sing this hymn together. It is, My Hope is Built on Nothing Else.
Gave you love.
Is it me or we did not like the hymn that they rendered? Ha. Thank you. You know, again, congratulations to Kareem. I just remember how many times that me, for example, will have to call Kareem to ask if daddy was at home. And I always say, Kareem, I feel calm now. Daddy day in a good mood. Kareem will say, come, no worry, just come. When you reach gate, call me. So looking at him receive this today, I'm really, really super proud of him. Because I can say that each of the time that I saw daddy, I never saw Kareem frowning. Not a time. Not a time. Always smiling. Always smiling. Ladies and gentlemen, for our fourth scripture reading, please, let's welcome Nosa Okumbo, who's taking a reading from the book of John, chapter 3, verse 25. The 6'8" basketballer of the family. Please give him a round of applause.
I'm going to be reading from John chapter 3, verse 25. Then there arose a question between some of John's disciples and the Jews about purifying. Blessed be the word of the Lord. Amen.
You need to thank your daddy for that good voice, man. Honestly, that is such a voice. Well done. Next up, we're going to have our last set of tributes. You guys have done really well tonight. I love the fact that the numbers haven't really reduced. Please put your hands together for yourselves. Thank you so much. Honestly, you're a fine audience, a very fine audience. Last set of tributes, please make welcome Adeswa Okumbo Rhodes, and then after her, we will have Deborah Okumbo. Please put your hands together for her. She makes her way to the stage.
I'll see you again. 'Cause good men never die. No.
Good evening, everyone. It is with a very heavy heart and with so much pain that I pen this tribute to my beloved father. I still can't believe you are no longer here with us, and it's very difficult to me to be standing here doing this. I still can't believe or comprehend the fact that I'm never going to see your physical body again, that I'm never going to see you witness significant milestones in my life, call me on my birthday, or see more grandchildren being born. Daddy, Daddy, as I fondly called him, was my father, my friend, my mentor, my advisor, my chairman, and my number one supporter. Watching Daddy growing up taught me the values of hard work, sacrifice, and focus. I'm so grateful that I had a great example and role model in my father, one that helped shape my career and my professional life. We always used to joke, often when people were around, no work, no chop. He was a man that believed to attain anything you want in life, you have to work for it. Nothing was ever handed to you. And I took that from him. One of my earliest childhood memories was when I was playing with my brother in the swimming pool. And Daddy tricked me. He said, come, come, let's push your brother into the swimming pool. And then he pushed me into the deep end. And I think that's a very great metaphor for our relationship. He taught me how to be independent from a very early age, and I'm very grateful to him for that. Thank you, Daddy, for your unwavering support of my dreams, making me believe that I could do anything I set my mind to, and making me believe that I could fly. Your support and belief in me made me what I am today, and I'm forever grateful. You always used to say I was a special child. I think you said that to all your children. But you were always there for me whenever I needed you. And I will do anything in my power to ensure that your dreams are fulfilled and that your legacy lives on with the same excellence that you taught us. I told you some years ago when I left salaried employment and ventured into the world of entrepreneurship that your name was more valuable than your money at this stage in my life. This was the reason I took permission from my amazing husband, Nick, to be Adesua Okumbo Rhodes for professional meetings only. Your name has helped open numerous doors, and I'm so proud that after more than 40 years of doing business in Nigeria, your name remains intact. Thank you, Daddy, for teaching me the importance of having a good name. Daddy was one of a kind. He was the epitome of kindness, generosity, passion, and care. He touched so many lives while he was with us. Your impact was felt across Nigeria and the world. I've had so many messages of kindness and kind acts that you did for people, a lot of which you did in secret. That was just who you were. That was just your nature. You were a man of conviction and passion, but most importantly, integrity. And I'm very proud to be called your daughter. You were a man of the people, and you were so humble. But you were also a visionary and a game changer, going to terrains that others wouldn't go to, and adding significant value to our country. I was always in awe of how you could balance so many attributes. You were sometimes a man of many opposites. You were a fighter that never backed down from a fight, but you were also the first to forgive. You were a perfectionist and also in the details, striving for perfection in everything that you did. But at the same time, you were able to see the bigger picture. You were a man of key principles. Your principles were hard work, generosity, integrity, patience, and forgiveness. I will carry these with me and your grandchildren. I will make sure your memory lives on in them. Following the diagnosis last year, I'm so happy about the time we spent together as a family in London. I saw you nearly every day for 8 months, praying together, eating together, and laughing together. Despite how busy I was with my own company, I proudly took on the role of your personal assistant during this period, and we became even closer in these last moments. It's hard to believe that I wouldn't be getting any calls from you first thing in the morning with instructions for the day ahead. I'm so happy that during this period, I was able to be some value to you after everything you have done for me. You have left us far too soon, but I know that you have fulfilled God's purpose here on earth, and I take comfort in the fact that God was merciful to you and gave you the time to reconcile with him before you died. I also thank God for giving you the time to spend quality time with all your children during this period. We had a beautiful time in London at Christmas and on your birthday. I remember you saying that these were the best days of your life. I take so much comfort that you are now resting with God in heaven. You are no longer in pain, and that you are in peace. Daddy, Daddy, I miss you so much. You are forever in my heart. I love you always. Dede, your loyal PA.
There's a home in the sky.
Let's all appreciate Adeshua, Adeshua Okumbo Rhodes, as we welcome Deborah Okumbo.
A place where your spirit never dies. This is in farewell. I'll see you again. Cause good men never die.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. Thank you for being here to honor our father. Daddy was an embodiment of love. Though he wasn't near perfect, he knew the heart of God. People, touching lives positively, affecting lives for good. I have heard so many testimonies in this period that has made me wonder that God did not want Daddy to die without receiving Christ because of the immense seed of kindness he had sown all through his life. He was a phenomenal father. He wanted every child to get the best education possible. I remember when it was time for me to go into secondary school, he insisted that I go to the best school in Nigeria at that time, Air Force Girls Military School in Jos. There I gave my life to Christ and began praying for the salvation of the souls of the members of my family, Daddy inclusive. When it was now time for me to go for my A-level abroad, as he insisted again, he borrowed money from a friend to pay my school fees. And not long afterwards, my siblings came over to England as well. Daddy would fly me to school. I remembered, as Bright was talking yesterday, exactly the same thing. Dad would fly me to school and have me in the cockpit while I schooled in Jos. This was before the Nigerian Air Force began flying our students to school in their C-130 planes. Even when he wasn't the one flying, he'd hand me over to the captain of the flight, who would also sit me in his cockpit and have the crew boss drop me off at schools. Instructors and officers at school thought he was in the Air Force because of his title, captain. Daddy would never smack you. But by the time he was done with his verbal rebuke, you would leave his presence having a rethink. He also wanted you to think, to see things differently. Take a good and deep look at situations and at things. He didn't want me to be docile. He was a friend to every child of his. He had nicknames for everyone. Then things went downhill. But Daddy's commitment to family was unflinching. Nothing could separate Dad from his children, regardless. He'd put his children first every time. Family is everything. Understanding your background, where you came from, is core to progress. This I have learned from him. Daddy believed in loyalty. He believed in Nigeria. He believed that everyone who had benefited from Nigeria, either through free education, business, or otherwise, should give back their quota to a nation who gave so much to them in various ways. Daddy loved peace. He loved being engaged, busy, productive, and active. This is evident in all his ventures and adventures. When he came to work, he was tenacious, resilient, persistent, hardworking, confident. He was a trailblazer, blessed by God and by man. At his weakest moment during his illness, God showed up to reconcile Daddy to himself. Daddy rededicated his life to Christ, gave in completely, trusted and believed God fully. He talked about how he'd share his testimony, how he'd rejoice, and was anxious about not failing God. Though he is no longer with us now, he has taught us to put God first and not last. His life has shown the forgiving and saving power of God. His life has shown that God is indeed merciful, and that he is God, and that he, God, will never cast away those who come to him. This is a great opportunity for us to reflect on our relationships with our Creator and ask for grace to live by his rules and live life his way. Daddy, I know surely by God's mercy we will meet again in the presence of the Lord to part no more. We miss you dearly. Sleep on. Thank you.
So beautiful to see the many colors of Captain Dr. Idahosa Wells Okumbo in the eyes of his children, which he raised as a very present father. Ladies and gentlemen, please turn your attention to the multimedia screens for the last part of the adieu video.
Which is the Lord's Prayer. And it's very short. But a lot of people don't understand it. But it's the most powerful prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
He did demonstrate that you don't have to be in government to impart on life of people. Now, a lot of people will talk about Captain, billionaire businessman. That is not what makes him unique. It is the heart.
Captain has changed a lot of people's lives. He has made a lot of people you see around him today, they were all made by Captain.
It's not just only a lost means. I call it my destiny helper. Katosa did so much to me. He made things. The things that look impossible in this earth made it a reality for me. It gave me a platform to rise. It gave me a platform to know that hard work really pays. I'm going to miss that father-son relationship.
Captain Idahosa Ogumbo came to this earth to put smiles in the lives of many and to share, you know.
There's more from that video. Just give us a quick moment to bring you the very last part of that video to ensure that we do justice in this farewell.
The memory of your dad are the blessing. So the children should pride themselves that they are children of Katios who touched life measurably, who give measurably, who love measurably.
And for the children, they should celebrate the life their father lives. Their father has opened many doors for them. That where others will go and seek, they will not even need to know. His goodness was all pervasive.
So it's for them to unite as a family, for them to work together as a family. The wish of Captain was, he has his children, for them, all of them to be one, to work as one strong family. And I pray that God will touch their hearts so that all of them we remember that their father have worked so hard for them. So they must all work together as a family.
And I believe that when you meet his children, they are well-behaved, hard-working, very intelligent, very unassuming. I believe that they are the greatest legacy that Captain Osa leaves behind, and that he did a great job in bringing them up and leaving them a name that I'm very confident they will live up to.
The peace and the unity that he preached while he was still with us here physically is strengthened by the family. That is what is most important after this. You know, it's not the grandeur of the celebration or whatever it is, it's to be able to live and strengthen what he believes in. That is the best we can do for him.
God Almighty grant his soul eternal rest and bless his family with fortitude to bear the loss.
He was a great, great, great father. A father like no other. I miss you, Daddy, and I love you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, please, I think Capitano deserves a better round of applause. At this juncture, Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, as we come towards the close of the day, permit me to invite Apostle Goodheart Ekweme, who at this point is going to have a special prayer for the family of Captain Idahosa Wells Okumbo. Please, a round of applause for the perfect gentleman of God.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. What a legacy, what a life well lived. What a legacy, what a life well lived. Please, can I ask for the Okumbo family to please step forward this evening? As we join heart and faith with them, to stand with them in this moment, just to encourage you as a family, the Bible declares in 1 Thessalonians 4:13-14. For now, dear brothers and sisters, we want you to know what will happen to the believers who have died, so you will not grieve like people who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and was raised to life, again we also believe that when Jesus returns, God will bring back with him the believers who have died. Be strengthened with the knowing that Daddy is in heaven. His last few days and weeks and months were days of walking intimately with Jesus on this side of eternity. Please, people, can we stretch forth our hand to speak a word of blessing over this family? Let's surround them with a wall of fire. Surround them with peace. And believe God that brought them together will keep them together. For when all the chips are down, it's about family. Father, we thank you. Lord, we bless you. We bless you for the legacy you've left behind through these ones. We are grateful for the times we spent with him. Now, Father, we ask that your hand remain strong upon them. You bring supernatural comfort by the Holy Ghost. We draw the bloodline round about them as a family, as a heritage, as a people of God. We decree and declare that none will die prematurely. We decree and declare by your mercy, you will preserve them to long, keen age in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We pray for good health. We pray for well-being. We pray for unity. We pray for togetherness. We pray they will remain stronger, bonded together, indivisible, unstoppable as a family in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, we ask for the help of the Holy Ghost. The Holy Spirit is the one who is able to reach out in those very quiet, silent moments. In the night when thoughts flash through their minds. In the day when thoughts flicker through their minds, Holy Spirit, strengthen. Let your succor be for them as a balm indeed. We thank you, our Father. As we come into tomorrow's service, we commend all activities to your loving hand. Thank you for strength. Thank you for peace. Thank you for a resting for your sons remain tomorrow, peacefully, joyfully, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We give you the praise and the glory. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Amen and amen. May you please be seated.
Thank you. As the family returns to their seat, thank you, Apostle Goodheart Akweme. I'd like to invite, for a vote of thanks, Osahon Okumo to speak on behalf of the family and thank everyone for coming through. Please put your hands together for him as you welcome her to the microphone.
There's a home in the sky, far above the big blue horizon, where you continue to fly.
Thank you for coming tonight. It's been a cocktail of emotions. First of all, I want to thank God for making this possible. I wanted to use this opportunity to particularly thank my uncle, my daddy now, Uncle Kingsley Okumbo. Uncle, I love you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Not just for what you've done this evening, what you showed us this evening, but for everything you've done this entire process, the way you've stood for us. God bless you. God bless you. Thank you. I want to thank everyone for coming today. I don't have much to say, to be honest. I'll leave it for tomorrow to speak about my father. There's a lot in my heart to speak, but I just want to thank you guys for coming down today. And have a good night. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, do not leave. We'd like to welcome the choir for our final hymn, Only Remembered. As they come up, I'd like to offer an apology to Mr. Osahon Okumbo. I didn't give him much time to put his thoughts together before springing that vote of thanks upon him. So that is not his doing, it was mine. This is our final hymn for the night. Please rise and join the choir to sing along, after which we will have a closing prayer. Please do not leave before then, and I would like to remind you. Thank you very much, choir. We appreciate you. And also a very big thank you to those of you who have been in attendance today. Honestly, You are a fine, fine audience. I wish I could take you guys to Lagos and teach our people some things. So well behaved, so decent. Your decorum has been admirable. Thank you so, so much. We appreciate you. You've gone a long way to make sure this evening has been one to remember for the family and a decent one for people who are in attendance. Thank you very much. We appreciate that.
And so with that, ladies and gentlemen, Your Excellencies, we invite you tomorrow morning to join us at 9 a.m. at the Air Force Base, Airport Road, pretty close to Prestige Hotel for the funeral service tomorrow, 9 a.m. Before we leave, we started with prayer. It is only but proper that we also close the event with prayers. Permit me to invite, to help us do justice to that, the Senior Pastor of Rock of Ages Christian Assembly, Raqqa, here in Benin City, Apostle Charles Osazua.
Ladies and gentlemen, we crave your indulgence. We ask for your full attention.
May we rise on our feet. Everyone, may we rise. May we rise on our feet and honor God. What has happened since this week has shown that life is donation, not necessarily duration. By the grace of God, Father, we commit this event that have started on a good note. And we trust as more people come in, grant them safety. As we gather tomorrow for the major event, I ask, O God, you will give us fair weather. I ask, O God, as we conclude in thanking you, at the end of this wonderful event, that all glory and honor will be returned back to you. At the end of this event, we believe you, O God of heaven, that everyone who came from different parts of the world will return back safely in Jesus' precious name. If you believe this prayer sincerely, can I hear your loudest say amen? Amen. God bless you. See you tomorrow.
It has been a pleasure and an honor serving as your MCs. We are Ike Osakiodua and...
My name is Sir FX the Entertainer. Thank you and have a good night.
Yeah. There's a home in the sky, far above the big blue horizon, where you continue to fly, a place where your spirit never dies. This isn't farewell.
Yeah.
I'll see you again.
Please remember that we asked you not to touch the family. Please,
good men
please,
never
ladies
die.
And gentlemen. Please remember, do not touch the family, please. Thank you. Thank you.
No. How do I start to tell the world your story? How do I write this beautiful journey? Yeah. Words are not enough. There's no time at all. But this isn't farewell. I'll see you again. Tears may fall. I know you're with God. I know it is well. I'll dry my eyes. I'll remember your smile. I know it is well. I know it is well.
It's like no other pain.